You're locked into Inception Radio Network, Superior, Wisconsin.
Now your host of California MUFON Radio, Lorien Fenton.
Welcome everyone to the California MUFON Radio Show. I'm your host, Lorien Fenton. Really glad you're all here with me tonight. It's going to be very interesting. I've got a gentleman by the name of Don Ware as my guest this evening. And it actually may be Ware. I'm going to ask him when we bring him on here in a few minutes if I'm pronouncing his name correctly. And he's got some interesting stuff to talk about. I met Don at International UFO Congress this year. I think I interviewed him for a few minutes on the radio show I was doing from International UFO Congress. And we had a nice little chat. So he has some amazing information for you guys. So I'm really happy to have him here with me tonight. But before we get started, you guys all know I do all the publicity for all the events at the beginning of the show. So I'm going to quickly get through them as fast as I can tonight. Let's start with the MUFON Symposium. Don't forget to go to MUFONsymposium.com and get your tickets. It's coming up in September. And it's the 24th through the 27th. If I remember correctly, and it's MUFONsymposium.com. Lots of fun people speaking, going to be a lot of MUFON people there, so I hope you guys are all prepared for that. It's going to be quite interesting, and I can't wait. So I'm going, and that brings me to the next little bit of business, is that I didn't launch the t-shirt campaign last week like I said I was going to, because I want to do it the 1st of August so I can run it for 4 weeks, and then at the end of August, what we'll do is we'll close it, and that way you guys get your t-shirts or your hoodies or whatever you want to order, and then I will have the money in time to go to the event. Because it takes them a few weeks to deal with closing out the campaign, apparently. So I did some research, so that's what we're going to do. We're going to run a 4-week campaign the whole month of August, and it will be just to get me to the MUFON Symposium in LA, and it's actually Irvine. And so that's going to be quite interesting. So I need your help, you guys, because I need to be there this year. It isn't even a choice of do I want to be there, is I have to be there. There's some things I need to do at the MUFON Symposium that hopefully will help everybody in MUFON. So and as you know, I'm starting a grievance committee here on my show. So so I think it's going to be fun. I think Jan Harsin is going to be very happy to see me in spite of the two or three things I've got to bring to his plate for him to deal with, because, you know, they're small things, like I said earlier on the show the last couple weeks, but they're things nonetheless that need to be addressed at MUFON. And they were inherited by Jan. They aren't anything that he created, that's for sure. They go back, you know, maybe a decade on. They're basically what they are, folks, you know, because I'm not being non-transparent about this. I just want you to know what I'm doing. They're issues that deal with how a nonprofit's run. There's just a few things that I think that they're doing that are not quite fair to everybody out there. So I think they need to be addressed, and I just think they need to be changed. The policies need to be changed, and they need to be looked at. And as running a nonprofit, several nonprofits for over a 30-year time span, I know exactly what I'm talking about. So hopefully they'll be listening to me, and these little changes will take place, and they'll benefit you as members. Trust me, I know this. I wouldn't be bringing them up to them to do these changes if I didn't think they'd be helping everybody out there that's in the membership. So that's what it's all about, really. Someday on the radio show, I may go through all of them, but it's almost ridiculous and pointless to do that unless it's Jan Harzen listening to it, because, or the board for that matter, because they really are policies and procedures about how to run a nonprofit. So nothing huge, but they would help you guys out in the long run. I can guarantee you that. So that's what I've got to do. I've got to be there to discuss these issues with them that I think are very important, because, you know, there's just ways to run a nonprofit that you don't run a regular business the way a nonprofit runs, and a nonprofit doesn't run the same way a regular business runs. So I just think that there are things that need to be addressed. So anyhow, that's my opinion, and I'm bringing it to them, and I think you guys would be very happy in the end of the outcome. So there you are. Anyhow, so I need to really be there this year. So I do need to do a campaign to raise a few $100 here and there just to get me to this event so that I can, you know, work. Actually, I'll be working on your behalf. I'll be working on behalf of IRN, and we'll just be, you know, spreading the love, as they say. And I will be interviewing all the speakers down at the MUFON Symposium, so you guys can get a taste of what it's like going on down there, just like I do at International UFO Congress. So I hope you guys are happy about that. I hope you buy t-shirts and hoodies. And, you know, it's getting to be, it's truly t-shirt weather, so I'm not sure I'm even going to put the hoodies on there. But for those of you back east, know that it's going to be super cold this winter. Maybe I will put the hoodies on there. I'll have to ask MJ about that. So we'll see. But anyhow, so, okay, enough of MUFON Symposium. That's what we, you know, that's what I'm working towards right now, is the MUFON Symposium. And the next thing that I wanted, the next event that I wanted to bring up for you guys, can you guys tell that I'm having trouble talking tonight? It's one of those nights where my tongue is just not following my brain. I don't know what's going on. Maybe I didn't get enough sleep last night. Anyhow, let's see, where was I? Oh, yes, my good friend Robert Potter and I were talking today, and he is putting on an event up in Mount Shasta that I find fascinating, and it's called the best, not the best of Mount Shasta. What am I saying here? Oh, my gosh, I can't believe I just said that. Wrong thing. Okay, and why is my computer doing some weird thing? Oh, my gosh, that just scared me. Oh, no, it is. It's doing some very strange thing. I'm trying to look up his website. It's called The Promise Revealed. Let's see if I can get it up there. R-E-A. I think it's R-E-A-V-E-A-L-E-D. I hope that's right. Okay. Anyhow, his website, thepromiserevealed.com, is... no, I'm not spelling it right. Thepromiserevealed.com. Check it out. It has the Shasta event on it. And check it out. It's got quite a few great speakers. There's camping. There's sky watches. There's all kinds of fun stuff going on up there. I might go up there for a day or two. It's August 19th through 23rd, I believe. Yeah, August 19th through 23rd. And it's going to be fun. He's doing it at a camping retreat center kind of place. So it's kind of rustic. It's got camping. It's got a few places for motorhomes. It's got, you know, it's that kind of place. It's not your Ritz Hotel. It's not even a Marriott or a Motel 6, but it's close if you've got a nice tent and a blow-up mattress. So there you go. No, it's going to be a lot of fun. I'm looking forward to it, and I wanted to promote it for him because he's been such a good friend over the years. So thepromiserevealed.com, check it out, and check out his event. I think it's called the Mount Shasta Promise Event or something like that, but you'll see it on his website. It's right there on the main page. And now that I can't get to it, so you'll have to get there for me, okay? So thepromiserevealed.com, check it out. Cool, fun event. And then, of course, comes in October, the end of October, is my event. It's called UFOCon, the Experiencer event, and it's going to be remarkable. I must say, Barbara Lamb, Lori McDonald, and Dr. Sasha Lesson are going to be giving, I don't know how to describe it, facilitating. Yeah, that's the word I'm looking for. They're facilitating 6 different experiencer workshops, or groups, or whatever you want to call them, they won't be doing hypnotherapy, but they will be doing some kind of meditation during these workshops, and they're going to be doing group sharing, and they're going to be just really cool. And the part I think is so amazing about this conference, even though it was my idea, so I am patting myself on the back for it, the part that I think is so cool is the fact that there'll be six different type of experiencer groups for six different types of experiencers. And like I said last week, they'll start with people who have just seen a UFO, people who have been dealing with reptilians their entire life, people that have been dealing with the grays their entire life, people that have had experiences with human-like entities. I think that's one of the things we're going to bring up. We're not sure there's that many people who've had that kind of experience, though, so we may combine it with extraterrestrial entities that might be angels or energy beings or those type of beings with the human type of experience and see if we can get some people to that event. I'm just not sure there's as many of those. It's very intriguing to me that they're a smaller group of it, but we're thinking about doing that as well. Plus, we're going to have one for people who feel that it was a positive, amazing experience, and they want to share what it was that was so great about it. And then we might have a group, and this is where I think we're having the trouble, is trying to decide if we want to have a group where people said it's all negative and it was horrible and we don't know if we want to talk to these things again. So we're still weighing those last two out and how we're going to approach them, but I'm telling you guys, it's the first time it's ever been done. I hope it works. I think it will. I think it's really important that we start breaking it down instead of just having, like I was saying last week, you know, you go to all these conferences now and they all have an experiencer group, but it ranges everything from the guy who just saw a craft outside his window one night when he was eight and never remembers or seen anything again, all the way to people who are being harassed and terrified almost on a nightly basis. And I have a friend like that back over in the East Bay. Unbelievable. She's in her 60s now and they're still harassing her every day. Almost every day. So, you know, what do you do? I mean, it really runs the gamut. And I think it's really important that it's being addressed at these conferences. And like I've said before, my conferences, very affordable. We're a nonprofit. We're not doing this to make big bucks. This isn't the goal here. The goal for us is to break even and educate and help people. So that's what my conferences are all about, folks. So please, if you can get there, it's Sacramento, California. It's October 24th and 25th. It's going to be phenomenal. And we have amazing speakers, too. I mean, I told you about this guy last week. I've got a guy that lives here in Petaluma, California, that I have convinced. He said he's going to do it now. So I'm really excited he's going to be there. He's going to come out for, you know, the second or third time. He's only come out to my MUFON group in Petaluma. It's a long story with MUFON, but he basically has not made a report to MUFON ever. This has been going on his entire life. He's 55 years old, and now he has some amazing things happening to him that I don't think are happening to anybody else. And he has proof. He has pictures. He has all kinds of great stuff. So I highly recommend, if you guys want to see a couple of people at an event that you've never seen before that have really new and fresh information, that you get to this conference, because it's going to blow your mind what this guy's going to be talking about. So anyhow, October 24th, 25th, Sacramento, California, go to CA, that's CA for California, caufocon.com. Check it out. Get your tickets soon. Prices are going up September 15th. So you've got about a month and a half to get them and get there. Okay. All right. I think that's it. I covered Shasta. I covered us. I covered MUFON Symposium. I'm just trying to think if there's anything else I'm going to that I think is... Oh, Paula Harris is having a conference in November. It's November 13th, 14th, and 15th, if I remember correctly. It's in Laughlin, Nevada, and it's going to be on consciousness and the human ETs in the 50s. And she did Giant Rock last year. I thought that was kind of interesting and fun. And she just does more consciousness related. It's not your typical UFO conference, but it's still very fun. A lot of spiritual consciousness energy going on at this conference. conference. I'm going to be there. I'm going to be doing some live broadcasting for IRN, hopefully, if we can get the feed going. And I think it's going to be a really, really good conference this year. So I hope you guys can make that. If you're like over in Nevada or Arizona, you're right near there. So hop on over to Laughlin and check it out, because it's right, I think it's right across the border from Kingman, if I remember correctly. And great fun had by all at the Aquarius Hotel. So I hope you guys can make that. Now, her website, I believe, is starworksusa.com. That's starworksusa.com. And I'll be having some of her people at her event on my show in the next few months. So that'll be fun, too. Okay, so now I've got all the conferences out of the way. I've done my job. I'm all set. And I hope you guys can make any or all of them. I think you'd really have some good times. Okay. So, Don Ware, are you with me, Mr. Don Ware? Don Ware?
I am, yes.
Okay, Don, now, am I saying your last name incorrectly? Is it Ware or Ware?
Ware,
W-A-R-E. Ware, okay. Don Ware. Like, Don, where are you?
Correct.
Is that correct?
Yes. My brother's name is Bob. They called him Beware.
Beware. Okay, I love that. That's so cool. Well, okay, so I met you at International UFO Congress, as I was telling everybody, and you were fascinating. I got to thank you for that, and just being there and being fun. And I noticed in your bio that you're actually having contact with extraterrestrials. Is this correct?
Well, I'm more of a contactee than I am an experiencer. I've actually don't think I've ever been abducted as such, but I have had a lot of contact experiences. I've had a lot of help in my education from what I call angels, aliens, and world government folks, and that's what's made my life quite interesting. And some of it involved my first board meeting when I was elected to be the Eastern Regional Director of MUFON. I was, I worked for MUFON for 10 years.
I didn't know that, Don. What capacity? Were you like a state director, or were you on the board?
I was an officer in the headquarters, United States, U.S. Air Forces, Europe, in 1980. One, I think it was, when I read the book called Casebook of a UFO Investigator. And I knew that after one more year in the headquarters, that would be the end of my three-year assignment, and I was going to make that the end of my Air Force career, 26 years for pay. And they kept me so busy in the Air Force, I didn't have time to spend my money. I was getting, temporary duty pay, family separation allowance, combat pay, flying F-105s over Vietnam. I had two combat tours there. I didn't have time to spend my money, so I knew when I was 46, I guess, and I read that book by your director of research. I wrote that casebook of UFO investigation, and I said, well, that sounds like something fun to do when I'm retired, and so I did. I retired at age 47, with 100% of my time to do whatever I wanted to do and enough money to do it.
That's wonderful.
That book, your MUFON director of research inspired me to have my first volunteer job when I got out of the service to become a UFO investigator, and that's what I told Walt Anders. And because of my long-time experience, because I've read everything I could find about UFOs since I saw seven red light-type UFOs flying around over Washington, D.C. in 1952, 26 July 52. And he recognized, and I'd been a MUFON. I was a NICAP member, and while I was still in college, Duke University. And I'd read all the books I could find in Air Force libraries all over the world. Plus, for 26 years before I read most everything in the Duke Million Dollar or million volume library at Duke. I read everything there, and I was interested in propulsion at the time. I was a mechanical engineer. And the most interesting stuff at the Duke Library on propulsion was in the American Rocket Society reports. I later found out that the head of that organization, President of American Rocket Society, was a CIA agent. And he was involved in the Robertson panel report in January of 53. But yeah, because of that, Walt Anderson invited me the first day I was officially retired, first day of January of 83, he invited me to be a state section director for the five western counties of Florida. And he only had one person in MUFON in Florida, and that was a naval officer at Pensacola Naval Air Station who just got reassigned. So there was nobody in those five western counties representing MUFON when I joined. And then a little over a year, that was, I think, November of 84, Norman Bean, who had been the state director for Florida, was 78 years old, ready to retire, and Walt Andrus asked me to if I'd take over that job, so I did, and that caused me to travel around Florida, not recruiting state section directors. So I got to know a lot of the people personally in Florida. And then, it got kind of interesting. I had a phone call Sunday afternoon from a lady in Orlando. Now, I lived in Fort Walton Beach, Florida. That's in the panhandle. And she said, "I need to talk to you."
And I said,
well, what do you want to talk about? She says, "Oh, no, I need to talk to you face to face." I said, "Okay." Looked on my calendar, and I said, "How about Wednesday morning, 9 o'clock? That was my first opening. And she said, "Okay, I'll be there." She spent the night in Destin, about 10 miles away, because it's a 350-mile drive or so. And a little over 300 down to Orlando. And she showed up, and she gave me a little book that she had written. Her experience has been as a journalist. And the book said, "Psychics Don't Scare Me Anymore." And then she gave me a little package of bookmarks that had a little Casper smiley face on it. and those said, "Psychics Don't Scare Me Anymore." Or maybe I gave you the wrong name for the little book. It was only about 4 inches high and, 3 inches, 3.5 inches wide or something like that. But it was that little book was a with pictures, it was a description of the transformation taking place on the planet and where UFOs, fit in the whole thing. And then she said, "This morning I received a message for you." And the message said, I wrote it down verbatim, said, "There's something going on the Eglin Air Force Base reservation that concerns them, involving nuclear weaponry that concerns them. It's like playing Russian roulette."
Wow.
And I didn't quite know what that meant. Because I didn't know anything. I was sure. I'd worked in the testing business at Eglin Air Force Base for 3 years before I went to Europe for those 3 years. And I knew that nobody would consider setting off a nuclear weapon on Eglin or on the ranges, the water ranges. It just made no sense to me. Now, I had, while in the Air Force, I was teaching all the other fighter pilots out all about the newest of the tactical nuclear weapons, anything up to a little over a megaton. We'd carry it. I babysat nuclear weapons for 8 years, I guess, off and on. And it really didn't make any sense to me what this message said. So about 2 weeks later, I woke up and the first thought in my mind was, you dummy, that lady drove 300 and some miles to give you this message. Maybe I'll do something about it. So I consulted another Air Force colonel, and he said, yeah, I think I'll do something about it. I didn't know what to do except to pass it on to somebody at Eglin Air Force Base, and I knew that the Gallup had a poll that said there's a direct relationship between higher education and acceptance of extraterrestrial intelligence. So I get on the phone. Now this is about 2 weeks after I received the message, but just before I was going to take a long tour, I was going to get married, actually, remarry. My first wife died, and we were going to be traveling a lot. So I called, I found out which general had the highest education and formal education, and I said I called the secretary and said I'd like an appointment with General so-and-so, and she says, well, his first open appointment is Tuesday. And I said, that's too late. It's going to have to be this afternoon or tomorrow morning. I'm leaving town. She says, what do you want to talk to him about? I said, I have a message from an unusual source I want to give to him directly. And she said, I said, 5 minutes max. She says, okay, I'll squeeze you in between the two staff meetings tomorrow morning. His aide, a lieutenant colonel, was just dying to know what I wanted to talk to him about. I wouldn't tell him. So I sat there, and he came out of the first staff meeting, saw me, and motioned me into his office with the, you know, the big shiny desk that they have their meetings at and stuff. Closed the door. And I passed on that message to him directly in the circumstances. And he says, I don't know everything going on this base. I knew there were 42 tenant organizations at Eglin. He said, but I know who does, and I will make sure they get the message. I thought that was a reasonable response. So I opened up my black briefcase, which people may have seen me carrying around at conferences. I've been going to conferences, UFO conferences, six times a year since 1983.
Wow, that's a lot, Don.
I've seen a lot of people. That's a lot. After I worked for MUFON for 10 years, I was one of the five U.S. directors of the International UFO Congress for 18 years.
That's right, with Bob Brown, correct?
Yes, and then I've been an advisor to the Exopolitics Institute for about 15 years now. A lot of stuff going on there. I got it.
Exactly. Email. Yep. Yep. Right. There is. Hey, Don.
Anyway.
Don, I need to interrupt you for just a second. Okay. We're going to be hitting our first break here in about 30 seconds or less. Oh, okay. Actually, it's right now.
Okay.
So we're going to need to take a break, folks, and we'll be back. And Don's going to tell us all of his stories when we return. So stay with us. Welcome back, everyone, to the California MUFON Radio Show. I'm your host, Lorien Fenton. We're here tonight with Mr. Don Ware, and we're having an interesting education, I must say. So far, Don has done some amazing things, and he's just started telling us about his MUFON experience and going off to the Eglin Air Force Base and talking to the colonel about what was going on from the woman who gave him the little book. So, Don, continue, because I'm fascinated to hear if they did anything about that.
Actually, it was a top general at Eglin, and when I opened my black briefcase and handed him the hard copy of what I just told him, that's what you do when you brief generals, I had underneath it Ed Walter's poster picture of the Gulf Breeze UFO sitting there 3 feet above, and he looked in my briefcase and he saw it and he pointed to it and said to me, I look at that. And he picked it out and looked at it and smiled and just said, very interesting. Neither he or I at that time knew that the message that I was sent to give him concerning the nuclear weapons at Eglin Air Force Base that was like playing Russian roulette, was associated with that flying saucer.
Really?
And really. And and what happened was about 5 or 6 months earlier, Leah Haley she had been sleeping with her husband in a hotel room in Columbus, Mississippi, when the ETs picked her up in what she sleeps in, her panties, and she was looking out the window of this vehicle as they were cruising down the beach from Gulf Breeze toward where I live, Fort Walton Beach. And as she came by the directed electromagnetic pulse device on the beach 10 miles from my home, Eglin was testing their top non-lethal weapon system, a directed electromagnetic pulse device. And they hit that vehicle that she was on, and it shut down their anti-gravity system, and they dropped down on the beach. And she said, normally when you're on board UFOs, you don't feel, you know, the G-forces, the falling sensation or anything. She says, I didn't know. She had been looking out of a window-like device at this ship that looked like a small destroyer. And she said, I didn't know whether I was unconscious or not. But the next thing I remembered, I was on my knees on the floor. And she got up, and the door was open. And she got up, and she walked out onto the beach on the door from this flying saucer. And there's a helicopter overhead circling. This is about first light, about 30 minutes before sunrise. And the helicopter was saying, don't move. Stay right where you are. There's a guy in a military uniform that has one of these Zetas, or maybe a Zeta Gopher, that is one of the biological robots.
Right.
The older guys with big almond eyes over his shoulder like a sack of potatoes. And this guy's telepathic, and he's pleading with her, with those, you know, telepathically, to protect him from these military guys. And she looks out about 200 or 300 yards out, just where the offshore sandbar is underwater. And she sees the ship, and they dropped a rope ladder down, and people came down, got in the little boat, and they came in to the beach, and they picked her up and took her back out to the ship out there, and she was climbing up the ladder, and there's another alien laying on the deck, and he was pleading telepathically for protection from these military guys. And then they give her a shot in the arm. She says she's barefoot. She can feel that the deck, when they took her downstairs, the deck was colder below decks than it was on deck. And that tells me that it's summertime, even though it's 30 minutes before sunrise, because the water temperature is 84 degrees out there, and the below decks they keep it about 74. So the next thing she knows, she loses consciousness as she gets to the bottom of the steps. And next thing she knows, she's wearing somebody's raincoat over her panties. And she walks down, she is being escorted off a plane, told not to look at the plane. She's taken into an Air Force or an American-made sedan car like the Air Force uses, but there's no writing on the car. They take her to the back door of a hotel, and one guy stays with her near where she can see into the dining room, while another one goes and gets a key, and they take her upstairs. And one guy stays with her in the hall while the other guy goes in with, you know, into the room where her husband is. Her husband's was kind of put, you know how they do, they kind of shut you, put you in Delta and lock you in Delta somehow so that you don't wake up.
Right.
While they got the spouse out. And then they gave her another shot right through her raincoat, and she remembers slithering down the wall as she loses consciousness. Now, she and her husband both wake up that afternoon and have no memory of anything happened. We all know, because Eisenhower was asked by MJ-12 to sign the treaty that makes a deal with the Pleiadians and the Zetas that we would not continue to try to shoot down their vehicles as they tried to save planet Earth from humanity that was destroying it. So, you know, they're in the process of giving humanity a bigger hard drive, a faster chip, and a USB port for telepathy. So that if they can't get us to change our ways here on the surface of this planet, then they help us get smarter. So we'll be smart enough to save this beautiful planet. That's the kind of thing that's going on. And Eisenhower required, when he required, he signed that treaty, to have them guarantee that the people they took on board their ships would not remember it. So they do that with pure telepathy. The ETs can. And this event showed me that the U.S. government can do the same thing, but they have to use a drug-assisted hypnotic process.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Yeah. So that was kind of interesting to me to see how that turned
Don,
out.
And, I've got to interrupt you for a second here because this is a burning question and I don't want to wait for a while to ask it. How did this woman and her husband in the hotel come to you to tell you this story? When did they remember it, and who are they? Do I know them? Are they on the circuit? Do they talk, or, you know, what's their story?
It happened in Florida. I was a state director. This is 89. I became the state director in, about the same time. It's about time I became the state director. It was about time I became the eastern regional director. The people in the 18 eastern states elected me to be their eastern regional director, so I was on the board.
Okay, great.
I was one of three people on the board that couldn't be hired or fired at the whim of Walt Andrews.
We're not even to go there, okay?
No. If you read the bylaws, it takes the majority of the board. There were 23 people on the board at the time of MUFON.
Gotcha.
But, people knew who I was in Florida, and so the lady brought her husband with her and asked to come and spend the night with me, and all day on Saturday, she told me what happened, and on Sunday, I told her what was going on in Florida concerning UFOs. And that led to Colonel Reed going with the lady's name, uses a pseudonym, Leah Haley. You know, or you may have read her book, Lost with the Key.
I have read her book, yeah.
Meaning the keys to the compartments of her mind. Well, she left her car in my driveway, and I left my car in Fort Walton Beach. Once we were trying to find out, you know, where all this stuff happened. And she investigated her part and found out that she was moving to Columbus, and she'd been staying in that hotel with her husband when she was picked up. So we knew about when, and we wanted to know, because she described, when she was out, she described this sand, sugary white sand with sea oats, low sand dune sea oats, no sign of any habitation. And I knew that about the only place you're going to find those conditions is Eglin Air Force Base. That's the 13 miles of sand between Navarre, Florida, and Fort Walton Beach, Florida. And the only way you're going to get there is by walking 13 miles of slanted beach. And she agreed to do that, and so we did that. And we got down the beach about 5 miles after we walked through the nudist beach. I was carrying binoculars. She was carrying a camera, but, you know, we didn't use them.
You were looking down at the time, right?
No, I just wasn't using my binoculars. So we get about 5 miles down the beach, and we find this phased array radar sitting on a military flatbed that had sensors around it. And that is the kind of motion sensors and stuff around this thing. Now, it's a restricted beach, and nobody's allowed on it. And we take note and take pictures and continue. And this thing is pointing in a low angle of elevation in the water south of Gulf Breeze.
Oh, wow.
And then she says, no, first thing we came to a spot on the beach, and Leah said, stop. She says, this looks like the place I got out of that vehicle. And she faced all four directions. She says, it feels like the place I got out of that vehicle. And then we walked another mile or so and found that phased array radar. And then we walked another mile or so and found a device on a big white base that had a big donut on a horseshoe that swiveled. It's an omnidirectional thing. And it had a black cable about the size of your wrist coming up to this, which is apparently carries a lot of electricity. And that was coming from inside a facility that also had heavy barbed wire fences and the security sensors and stuff. And there was a wooden stand up to it, and it had a warning light and a trailer, a little air-conditioned trailer there. And we took pictures of that, and it was that donut was pointing in the same direction as the phased array radar.
Interesting. Wow.
And then we walked on down, and so we had these pictures, and my next lecture was in San Diego. I was invited to speak in California, one place in Los Angeles and one down in San Diego. And as I gave that lecture to the San Diego UFO Society, I think it was called, when it was over, an old white-haired gentleman in the back of the room came up to me and said, when I saw that picture, I got chills up and down my spine. I was the engineer that made the drawings for that device, and you have correctly named it. It is a directed electromagnetic pulse device.
Wow. Now,
I thought that was a neat coincidence.
Very interesting. So let me ask you, so you guys find this place, we know that she's been taken on the craft, we know that the military has put her back on into the hotel, we know all this has happened. Have you ever, in your travels around the United States or wherever you go for these conventions, ever met the guys in the helicopter in the military to come forward and corroborate the story?
The helicopter... Which helicopter are you talking
about?
Yeah,
the helicopter that took the woman and the guy who had the ET, the gray over his shoulder like a sack of potatoes, and the people on the boat where she was taken to.
I haven't met that guy, but in other cases in the area, out of Herbert, for example, some of my friends there would see a helicopter flying down the beach.
Oh,
you know, and then they would see this huge, big UFO hovering over the beach, and the helicopter gets close to it. It shines a beam on it, and the helicopter turns around and goes the other way.
Huh.
And I did get to our team interviewed those guys. The pilots wouldn't talk to us, so they went on to Hurlburt Field and they got a hold of the ground crews for the helicopter. And ask them what happened that night at that time. So the officers are less likely to, you know, get excited and talk about that kind of thing than the ground crew that hear what the officers tell them as soon as they get back on the ground.
Wow.
Yeah, we had lots of sightings there. Actually, the case of Ed Walters was, in my records, Northwest Florida MUFON case number 15.
Oh, great. Well, shall we talk about that? Because I haven't heard about the Ed Walters case for a long time. I'd love to rehash it. So do you want to talk about it? Were you the first investigator for that case?
Well, I'm also a birder. My card says I'm a truth seeker and birder. I'm a birder.
I love
a birder. I fell in love with birds when I was 7 years old.
Oh,
I became
cool.
A truth seeker when I saw the seven UFOs over Washington, D.C. in 1952.
Right. Right.
Yeah.
And Don, let me, I've got to ask you something. This has really bothered me all these years. It's 1952. You saw those UFOs. So did what? About 100,000 or more? 200,000 people? I don't know. All saw these UFOs.
I only know seven of them, but I'm sure there were hundreds of people in the D.C. area that saw them.
Oh, easily hundreds, if not thousands, if not hundreds of thousands. So
most of them saw the videos of them.
Oh, okay. I see what you're saying. Okay. Yeah. So firsthand witnesses, probably not as many, but secondhand, right. Yes. Okay. So
let me ask you this. At least 100.
Yeah. 100 people. Okay. Easily. So why wasn't that become the most talked about extraordinary experience of the whole history of the United States? That's what I can't figure out. I sit back and I say, if today, that many craft flew over the White House in Washington, D.C., and everybody saw it, it would be the talk for years. I mean, it wouldn't even be like a fraction of a second. It would be years. It'd be analyzed to death.
You are aware that we have a shadow world government that controls all the major media. Are you aware of the organizational chart of the shadow world government? Just how it operates?
I am, and it depends on which chart you're looking at, because I've got friends.
I'm looking at the 1991 chart released by Colonel Steve Wilson just before he died of cancer.
Oh, okay.
April 91, and that chart. Steve Wilson was head of the 1010 Special Security Squadron, and he's the guy that was tasking the crash retrieval teams and the men in black.
Oh, I love this guy.
And this was released 13, 14 years ago, and the people that work there at the NRO now, which we now call the Shadow World Government Headquarters, it's already taken over the entire role of Majestic 12 of the 5412 committee. They changed the name to when Eisenhower got in power in 54. And PI-40, this is actually a document. The thing I'm looking at right now is a document out of a PI-40 manual. And he released it to us. And those guys are ticked off because us dummies who claim to be interested in UFOs have chosen not to talk about this piece of paper that describes who it is as a public face of the shadow world government, who runs the crash retrieval teams and the men in black, it shows that IBM has the contract for computer services for our cities in under the crust of this planet, our underground cities, and our cities on the Mars and the moon and, the lunar operations.
Right.
Center. This shows how all that works. And they were ticked off because everybody feared the shadow world government because it's human nature to fear what you don't understand.
Right.
And so I'm not sure how many people have this chart memorized, but MUFON people certainly should.
Well, I'd love to talk a little bit about it. So do you have it in front of you? Because I can't bring it up on the internet.
I do have it in front of me, and I would love to describe it to your people. I'll try to go through it pretty quick.
Okay.
Okay, Star Wars Cities is, on this chart, is located under Cheyenne Mountain, and it has a direct connection to the President of the United States, and it also has another direct connection to the National Reconnaissance Office, which happens to be the smallest box on this chart. However, I'm told by a guy who works there who contacted me to share information with me both ways, and he tells me that the NRO is the size of two combined departments of the U.S. government, and their public face is the National Security Council, the National Security Agency, which is not a U.S. organization. It just happens to have a big office in the U.S. It's a world organization, as is the CIA. It's a world organization. It has been for a long time. And the director of Central Intelligence is the other guy. Then you got the Air Force Academy Air Force Special Academy box, which happens to be accessible from the grounds of the Air Force Academy. The Special Academy trains the astronauts for the NRO.
That
is for solar warden and all that. Whereas above ground, they train the astronauts for the U.S. government. And then you've got your Consolidated Space Operations Center and the North American Aerospace Command. And let's see, that's a lot involved in Colorado because you got Peterson Air Force Base where the Space Command is. And then it goes down, I told you about IBM, and it has Rockefeller down the bottom, Rockefeller Company, who manages the funding for all these bases on the moon and Mars and whatever, and the underground system here. And the other organizations that create the stuff they need to operate, the inner-Earth cities and the off-planet bases, and all those fantastic flying saucers. You know, these flying saucers that humans on this planet have and have built, with a little help from outside, they have superliminal travel, they have zero-point energy sources, and we think this stuff is just in our fiction. It's not. Our fiction is just a way to show us what's really going on. So you got Rockwell International Enterprises, and I found online, I found their organizational chart for the development of all these different off-planet bases and weapons, not weapon systems, but you know, high-tech transportation systems. You got Martin Marietta. I don't know if you're aware that the aviation company Martin teamed up with the mining company in Ohio, Marietta.
I did know that. Yep.
You did know that?
I did. Well, yeah. The only reason is because my family's involvement in mining. But go ahead.
Well, they got the contract to enlarge the underground caverns so you can put a lot more stuff in them. You know, millions of people have habitation there waiting for them. I don't know if you're familiar with Ruth Montgomery and her series of books.
I am. It's been a very long time since I've read them.
She was brought out of retirement. She retired in 89, I think it was. And she got a nice penthouse down on the beach here in Florida. And her husband died, and her husband joined her spirit guides that were feeding her all those books about, you know, aliens,
right,
among us,
right,
and stuff. And he joined them, and they put enough pressure on her to bring her out of retirement. In 1999,
wow,
she wrote one more book. It's called The World to Come.
Oh, that's right. Okay, now, Don, I can't believe this. I just looked down, and we've got to take our second break. I'm enthralled by what you're saying. I forgot to look at the clock. Okay, everybody, stay with us. We got more to come. We'll be right back. Welcome back, everyone, to the California MUFON Radio Show. I'm your host, Lorien Fenton. And I just want to say, if you guys haven't gotten your app here at IRN, you really need to do that, because that app, I'm telling you, if it wasn't for that app, I don't think I'd make it home in time from work to do my show at night. So if it's reminding me, it can remind you too. So get the app. It's wonderful. It keeps me on check. Point, as they say. And then one other thing I wanted to mention is that the t-shirts will be advertised on the website. That's from teespring.com. So you'll see a banner here at IRN in the near future that says Get Lorien to MUFON Symposium, and you'll be able to buy your shirts and support the cause, and I really appreciate that. And then the one final thing is, have you become a member of the IRN Insiders Club? The Insiders Club, it's so cool. And I promise you, folks, I haven't had the chance yet because I had so many technical difficulties at contact, and I've just, everywhere I've been going lately, I haven't been able to get an internet feed. I haven't been able to record. Different things have been happening that are just keeping me from doing these very cool specials that I want to do for you guys. And hopefully, and I'm just keeping all my toes and fingers crossed that in the future, more opportunities will come my way, and I'll be able to do so. So please, you know, just support the Insiders Club. More stuff's coming, and there you have it. And I think MJ is telling me, don't forget to subscribe to the IRN YouTube page. So there you go. You just go to IRN on YouTube and listen to past shows and all kinds of things on our YouTube channel. I keep forgetting we have the YouTube channel. Thank you, MJ. All right, folks. So there it is. Those are the things I need to take care of here at the top of the hour now. Dawn, are you still with me?
I am. I've got a couple of loose ends to clean up.
Sure you do. Okay, you go ahead. We were just talking about Ruth Montgomery, if I remember correctly.
Concerning her book that she was brought out of retirement to write, The World to Come, highly recommend people read that. The story was similar to what the Zeta said in Zeta Talk. You know, I was the first one to invite Nancy Leader to go out to speak at a conference.
And, oh, wonderful.
And I think she's doing great service for humanity. But the scenario she was describing was similar to what Zeta Talk was talking about in 2003, and of course it didn't happen at that time, but she has been helped preparing people for some kind of Earth traumas ever since. And I think that served a purpose. So the next loose end was the Star Wars city chart. I'm just going to name the companies that create the stuff that we use in our off-planet bases. And we talked about Martin Marietta. Lockheed, you know, has the Skunk Works.
Right.
And Boeing has their Phantom Works. But
yep.
Lockheed was, or Dr. Romig, the current head, and I think only third head of the Lockheed Skunk Works since back in the 50s, he came to speak to the Georgia Tech graduate aerospace engineers. And I got an invitation to come sit right in the middle because they knew it was going to be standing room only. And he talked about Dark Star, showed pictures of Dark Star, which you hear people talking about now. And if you watch Wilcox interviews with Corey Good, that's kind of interesting. Then you've got, let's see, Teledyne Ryan Aerojet Electro Systems. A lot of these are there in Southern California. McDonnell Douglas, Ford Aerospace, Fujiaka Company. If you saw Sagan's movie Contact, you saw that the Japanese were heavily involved in off-planet industrial stuff. Cayman Industries has about 200 distribution centers.
Hmm.
Just like Walmart has 200 distribution centers to provide the people on the surface of this planet the stuff they like to have. Cayman distributes from all these companies I just named the stuff they need in the inner Earth society and the off-planet bases, and all these fantastic flying machines. Now, I do want to mention one paper that's on that MUFON people probably, if they're just starters, would be like to read. It's called The Long-Term Government Covert Educational Program on Alien Visitors, and that's published at exopolitics.org. Look in the Exopolitics Journal, and it's in Volume 1, Number 1. I think you'll find that interesting, putting together a lot of stuff I learned along the way. Now, I have been used, I think, to get to the public two books written by John B. Leith, which I've just finished doing. I've spent the last 2 years of my life primarily working on that, 2 years and 2 months. John B. Leith was born in 1920 with a photographic memory.
Hmm.
And in 1937, he had graduated from high school, and he went on a spiritual path and had some amazing experiences. And then he everybody was joining the military, and he was working at a desk job down in Panama when Wild Bill Donovan, head of the OSS, that's the world-level special forces, we call them now Delta Forces, I think, recruited him to lead a six-man special forces team, I think they call them McGregor teams back then, behind German lines 62 times.
Oh, my God.
Breaking out prisoners, VIP prisoners, was one of their main tasks. That was their expertise, out of jails in France, Germany, and Poland.
Ah.
And it's interesting that he found in his spiritual path, sitting in a cave in Lhasa, Tibet, at age 17, that he was the man who, he was the soldier, the Roman soldier that stuck the spear of destiny into the heart of Jesus to make sure he was dead. He'd already died. He had left his physical body. But he's the guy that did that. So it's not karma in my mind, but he was used by Eisenhower in World War II on his 61st mission to make sure that Eisenhower wanted those Christian relics to stay in Germany and not be captured by the Russians, these, you know, these pagans. I don't know what they call them, but they're not religious. And that was pretty exciting. And then he was told by Wild Bill Donovan when the war was over in 45 that he was not allowed to acknowledge that he had any combat experience, even though his 62 missions had caused him to win the top award for valor from seven different nations. He is the most highly decorated soldier of any war, and nobody had, six people had read his story in that paper manuscript. And so I got that published last October. It's called The Man with the Golden Sword.
Oh,
and
cool.
It sees how he was led. He was the guy that was the liaison between Patton and General von Rundstedt on the Western forces. And after Hitler left, left Germany 4 or 5 months before the war was over, then von Rundstedt had the title commander of all German forces. And the Germans were fleeing like a sinking ship. And
yes.
He found that some of these, a lot of the people that would come through, these officers and scientists, would come through his headquarters, von Rundstedt's headquarters, and somebody had a triage list about who is a really good guy and who is a bad guy. And the good guys were allowed to get on flying saucers and being taken down to New Berlin, entrance in where Admiral Byrd went, in Neuschwabenland is what they call
right.
that whole southern part. And the large numbers of young blue-eyed blonde soldiers and women. Wendell Stevens did a lot of research on this, and he said there were 20,000 that he was aware of the young soldiers and 20,000 women who would get on trains that carried 500 people along back tracks overnight, and Hitler had this deal with Franco to use a couple of ports on the northern coast of Spain, and 500 of them, before it got light, would get off that train and get on that submarine that carried 500 people, and they go straight down to New Berlin. And he learned things, and one of the people he interacted with there was called Father John. And his name, Lee's name, was code name for, was Colonel Halford Williams. But this book described, he knew he couldn't, after the war, he couldn't talk about his experience, so he had to write it. And so he stayed in Europe using a GI Bill to study literature at Oxford, and he described 12 of his 62 missions. And then he went back in 1950, he went to Canada, and he married a lady, and he went back to school for journalism, degree in journalism, and he worked as a journalist for 25 years. And then the CIA in 1975 told him to go down to Clearwater, Florida, and team up with the other OSS agent, whose real name is Frank Hudson, but was Father John in the first book, in the war.
Okay.
And those two were used by the CIA to interview all the VIPs from the inner Earth. That is the ambassador from Shambhala, which happens to have an entrance to it. I know where the entrance is to Shambhala, by the way. But he came up
cool.
through an entrance. Since you're going there, I guess soon. If you park your car in the upper parking lot, you walk up just less than a mile on the left, back in the woods. There's a hidden entrance there, but I doubt that you'll find it.
Hold on. Where is this again? You said I'm going there. I didn't know I was
going
there.
I thought you were going to Mount Shasta.
Oh, Mount Shasta. Oh, yeah,
Mount Shasta.
Yeah.
It's in California,
oh, yes, I'm
right?
Definitely going to Shasta.
Okay. Well, you're going to be sitting right on top of the entrance to Mount Shasta.
Oh, cool.
But these guys, the Atlanteans, you know, there are lots of Atlanteans that chose not to leave the planet when the last of their islands went under 10,500 years ago. But they have a deal with the Icelandic government. There's an entrance in Iceland.
Oh, okay.
So you might find Atlanteans wandering around this world using Icelandic passports, which I think is kind of interesting. Bormann, when he left Germany with Hitler on the same submarine, he was not allowed. Neither one of those guys were allowed to go into the inner Earth. But he was able to buy 10,000 blank Argentinian passports from Franco. And he did, there's good documentation of him spending the first 2 years after the war in a penthouse in Buenos Aires, the best quarters there. And it was a double that went down with Eva Braun and Hitler's son, born to Eva Braun in 1940. That was one of the three doubles that Hitler had. One of the missions of John B. Leith as Colonel Halford Williams was to find out how many doubles he had. And they actually broke in through the sewer system into the palace where the Fuhrer was staying. And they actually found four different size sets of uniforms. Presumably one of them was Hitler's, but the other three were doubles. And they videotaped them, putting on their makeup and all that kind of stuff. Pretty interesting stuff. So the CIA chose this guy for two reasons. Besides having 25 years experience as a journalist and a photographic memory, he had proven that he could go for 30 years without ever acknowledging he had any wartime experience. So they knew he could keep the secrets until after he was dead, because he wasn't able to tell about the development of the round-wing plane or the flying saucers in detail in the U.S. and in Europe, in Germany. And it's an amazing story in this book that just came out last week called
Oh my God.
Genesis for the Space Race, the Inner Earth and the Extraterrestrials.
Okay, now wait, hold on, Don. Okay. Where do people find this book?
I found the original manuscripts of both of these books in the home of Robin Andrews in Chamblee, Georgia, 15 miles from where I lived. And I recognized that this stuff has to be published. And so three people wrote a statement on the back. We have a really good depictions of Project High Jump. You can go to the website, Wikipedia, and read for a long time on Project High Jump. And now they've released U.S. government released to the Russians some previously classified film for their new video on Project High Jump, which shows these flying saucers, which some people think are German, but they aren't. It's generally the same design. These are the old Viking flying saucers that are using their beam weapons to shoot down our fighter planes. That is, Byrd's fighter planes, and sink some of his military, at least one of his military ships. Mm-hmm. On the back here, my statement says, this CIA-assisted book is closer to official disclosure than the general public will see before the return of Christ.
Interesting.
And, Robin, the owner's book, says, the author, John B. Leith, a dear friend, considered this book his life work. He wrote it very well and documented it superbly with fellow researcher Frank Hudson. It should change your view of world reality. That's one of the things changing it, because there are, you know, things being interviews that are taking place now with more recent people. People that just retired, like Corey. And then Michael Laforte, who owns the copyright on John Leith stuff and has been a serious researcher of Leith and all of his friends, says this book is the most comprehensive book on guarded information in UFO history.
Oh, my God, that's amazing. So how do we buy the book, Don? How do we buy the book? Can I go to Amazon and get it?
You can get the first one off Amazon as a Kindle or hard copy, but you can get both of them off of Time Stream Pictures, if you'll just write that down. Time Stream Pictures, all one word.
Pictures.com?
T-I-M-E-S.com, yeah.
Great. I'm putting
and
it in the website.
You should see both of those. Yeah, put that in your website and put that up there, because this stuff just came out, and it has the kind of stuff that MUFON people are looking for, because it's got the documentation.
Wow.
It's okay. Amazing. Actually, the first book, The Genesis of Space Race, after they spent, these two guys spent multiple face-to-face meetings with the ambassador to Earth from Venus, the professor from Shambhala, who is an Atlantean professor, interviewed face-to-face Hitler's son, born 1940, to Eva Braun, who actually came up from New Berlin and got his education at Harvard, because nobody there would know him. He was 5 years old when he left Germany. And some really other, the head diplomat that lives in the inner earth came up and had interviews with him. And then they had more interviews. The two of them together had multiple interviews in multiple places, like New York and Washington. And then they had more follow-on interviews in order to write that book on the telephone with these guys. So it's pretty amazing stuff. It's the kind of stuff that MUFON guys like to research. And then after he did that in 1980, he researched the aftermath of his 12 missions in the secret history of World War II.
Oh, my God. This is amazing. It's called Genesis? Is that the book?
Genesis for the Space Race.
Wow, cool.
The Inner Earth and the Extraterrestrials.
Oh, this is good. Yeah, it's right here on timestreampictures.com, you guys. The cover looks interesting. I'm going to click on the synopsis and check it out. But anyhow, yeah, you guys go there and get the book. It looks very cool. Okay, so this is all really, really cool stuff, Don. But I want to, before we have to take another break, you had a poem you wanted to read about MUFON. Can you do it in 2 minutes?
Well, two and a half, maybe.
Okay, let's see what we can do.
It's called Bulletins from Space. The date is 23 June 1989.
I'm ready
for it. The highest level messages from space vehicles are spoken through two basic types of individuals, those who are simple, pure, childlike vessels, and those who are highly illuminated with the light. Those who dabble with the metaphysical accoutrements or seek in any way personal aggrandizement or control are not used as torches for the spiritual light messages. This means that it is often possible to discern the degree of validity of channeled messages by observing behavior and philosophy of the vessels. We are so weary of mankind being so unobservant of the things around. So many think the owl is wise, for it sits in the trees and seems to despise all beneath its perch on high. Yet in reality, this bird is prey. Bird of prey is mesmerized in the light of day and lives to hunt when the sun is gone, to eat tiny creatures who've done him no wrong, So too your wise men sit on high and think they're wise, but in reality they're all in stupors. Seeing naught and without much thought, they wait till dark and prey upon some lonely heart who's run amok upon the ground, and they never soar where eagles are found. For too long the owls have reigned within MUFON, and all of us in space grow most weary of this disgrace. It's time for heads to turn on high, where eagles soar and the answers rise. It's time for those without the spirit to relinquish their perches to those who are with it, to those who can see the souls and not just the vehicles where they are enclosed. End point.
Oh, my God. I love it. And I got to say, you know, that was written in, what, 1998, you said?
1989.
89.
Okay. 98 is when these died. But this is on my website, freewebs.com. This paper, this paper is titled "Telepathic Communications and UFO Phenomenon." Four messages from that same source are there.
Great. We'll talk about those more because we're going to have to take a break here in just a second. So when we get back, can we do that? And I also want to talk about, you mentioned you have 15 messages that you were given, and I'd love to hear about them all too. So that'd be really fun.
It's easier, it's easier just to go to freewebs.com/Don Ware and read them.
Well, that's true.
Everybody.
That's true. Now, since
that's why I put them there, to save people's time.
Oh, okay. So, okay. Well, let's take our break and we'll talk about that when we get back, folks. So hang in there. We got a little bit more time with Don Ware tonight. I'm so happy he's here. So we'll be right back. Welcome back, everyone, to the California MUFON Radio Show. I'm your host, Lorien Fenton. And, you know, I forgot to mention this earlier as well. Don't forget, we're rebroadcast here through the gracious givenness. I don't even know how to describe it. The graciousness of IRN on Late Night in the Midlands with Mike Vara and at Veterans Truth Radio Network. So if you don't catch us here, you can always catch us there. But I hope you're here with me here live on Wednesday nights. So anyhow, Don, are you still with me?
I am.
Thank you.
Yes.
So now what we were talking about right before the break was the fact that you have these different points on your website, and I picked some that I really want to talk about. And did you have something you wanted to finish up with from our last, before we hit the break?
Not that I can remember, but let's get on with telepathic communications a bit.
Yes. Okay. There was point number 10 on Don's website says telepathic communications and the ET. It's telepathic communications and the UFO phenomena.
Yes.
Great. Well, so tell us about that.
While I was in the service, I only had, and at Duke, I only had time to study UFOs and spirituality. When I, at 47, was able to retire and had more time to read than other MUFON people, I chose all the persistent mysteries of mankind and did a pretty good thorough search on that, wrote a paper on it as I moved on to the next subject. And then I put all those papers, a lot of them, on the website, free website. So they're archived there for a decade so people can read them. And on the one called Telepathic Communications and UFO Phenomenon, you see some strange alien writing that's on the front page there. That writing is from Shirley Coyne, who is the Michigan State Director for MUFON and the wife of the Central State Director, her husband, George Coyne, who, by the way, has given us these little devices that they shove up your nose, up your right nostril into your brain.
Oh, my God, yeah.
So, you know, I've seen those under electron microscope twice. And Lisa Royal is the one that asked the Atlantean, or excuse me, the Zeta genetic engineer, what they're for, which I thought was interesting. And there's a connection here with all the MUFON researchers. And they said, well, since they're designing these more advanced human bodies whose IQs are about twice the normal human IQ, they look like what's on the cover of Time magazine, 23 June 97. World government guys tell us they call them Homo Alterio Spatialis, higher human from space. So these guys, just a minute, where was I going with this? This Shirley was asked by your director of research at the time, no, director of investigations on the telephone. They're talking about her grading the MUFON tests. And she, not thinking about it, had doodled this strange alien writing on a little piece of paper while she was talking to Dan about the grading of tests. And so that got us into researching her story, and it was really interesting. She was 9 years old when she was being taken on board and taught that strange alien language. Now, I mentioned the ETs like to use poetry to get their messages across. So I'm looking at a poem that I wrote while the lights were down a little bit. I was a Noetic Sciences Symposium in Boca Raton. And Joan Borisenko was the lecturer. I'd never heard her lecture, so I had my yellow pad out, and I was taking detailed notes. And 5 minutes into the lecture, I flipped the page over. I wrote natural science up top, and then I wrote 12 lines of poetry. Let me read it to you.
Sure.
God is all that is. God is love and light. Light, with quotes around it, or energy, can be condensed to form quarks. Quarks combine to form protons and neutrons. Protons and neutrons are glued together to form atoms. Atoms combine electromagnetically to form molecules. Molecules combine, accumulate, or grow to form living bodies for the spirit, for the love of God.
That's beautiful. It's true, too.
Yeah, the words aren't new to me because I do have a master's degree in nuclear engineering.
Well, that's correct. You do, don't you? So, cool.
And while I was at AFIT, I got that at AFIT, and I had time for only three electives. I chose to study electromagnetic propulsion systems, physics of the upper atmosphere. You know, I had in the back of my mind when I retired, I'd become a UFO investigator, and I thought these would be good things for being a MUFON investigator.
Cool. Well, great. Okay, so we've covered a little bit of number 10, and we could go on and on about it, but what I'd like to talk about now is the My Alien Doctor, which is number 3.
Okay, quickly, this involves California, too, because International UFO Congress, we invited Clarice Bernhardt. She had a radio show in California, like yourself, maybe. She was from Canada originally, I think, and she's telepathic, and she gets a telepathic message from what she calls her spirit guides that says that at 3 o'clock at a certain place in California, there's going to be a 5.2 magnitude earthquake on Thursday, 3 o'clock. This is on Monday or Tuesday she gets this message. Her radio show is on Tuesday. She thinks to herself, wow, should I announce that to the public on my Tuesday radio show? And she decided to do it. So a lot of people heard it. Well, on Thursday at 3:01, there was a 5.2 magnitude earthquake at that spot.
Oh, my God.
So the scientists that study earthquake prediction called her and said, how did you do that? And she said, my spirit guides told me. So they invited her to the next international conference on earthquake prediction in Colorado. And I had exchanged cards with her because I was a director and I'd never met her before. 1 month later, I get an email from her. And she says, when I first arrived at that conference there in Nevada, a strangely dressed alien appeared in my vision.
Oh, wow.
He had this black, looked like a bicycle racing hat, had ventilation holes in it, and a black, what looked like patent leather chin strap. He had black patent leather ankle boots, little booties that came up, to the ankle, gray slacks, and a gray waistcoat that had a seam that came up the side like on Star Trek. And she said he didn't say anything. She just had the feeling he was there checking on who was at the conference. And then she says, in my meditation this morning, that same strangely dressed alien appeared in my bedroom.
Oh.
And he said, I want you to send a message to Donald Ware.
Okay.
And the message was that, quote, in addition to the other things I do to maintain my health, it would be good if I took CoQ10. She knew what CoQ10 was. I didn't. She explained it to me.
Oh, my
God.
When Sam's
bought some, I've been taking 100 milligrams of CoQ10 every day since. This was many years ago.
Oh, that's amazing.
It's good. It's good for maintaining the health of your two most important organs, your skin and your heart.
Oh, I better start taking it then.
a lot of people are involved with ETs take it.
Okay,
it's a strong antioxidant.
Good.
You know, we need antioxidants to help us stay healthy.
Absolutely.
Now, my thought as a result of that was I had my dermatologist find something in the middle of my back I had not seen. He thought it was suspicious. He took his little roller knife and he said, biopsied it. 3 days later, I get a call from his nurse and says, yeah, it was a basal cell carcinoma, and they got it all. Don't have to worry about it. Just come back next year. So,
great.
My question is, did that ET, or her spirit guide, or whoever it is, how did he diagnose the fact that I needed to start taking IQ-10, or CoQ-10?
Well,
I never got
you know,
a good
Don,
answer to that.
I have an answer for you if you want to hear about it. I've had some amazing experiences in my life, none of them really with ETs. I've always had an angel with me or two or three or somebody watching out for me because they talk to me and tell me when there's danger and do all kinds of things. And I have these prophetic kind of visions or dreams when I'm waking up or going to sleep, usually waking up. And I've had some, like I said, extraordinary experiences, and they're going to be in my book. But I had a real blast in September of 2013, and this is how all of this started for me, where I became public. It was because I was sitting in front of a computer, and I had a thought about the woman in the room next to me. She had experienced something with me about 4 months earlier, where a helicopter came over my house, and she could hear it through the telephone. Okay. Mm-hmm. And I'm sitting at the edge of the bed, and I thought to myself, I wonder if this woman who just walked into the other room and was getting ready for bed and getting into bed, remembered the time the helicopter came over the house. And in that instant, and I mean instant, there was a helicopter over the house I was in, and it was so loud I thought it was waking up all the neighbors. I thought it was going to shake the house. That's how loud it was. And then I went and I looked out the window, and there was no helicopter but three orange balls of light above the house in a triangle formation.
Mm-hmm.
So the next day I asked everybody, did you hear the helicopter? Because they'd just gone to bed. They couldn't have been asleep yet. And they basically, everybody said, no, we never heard anything last night. So in that moment, I realized they can read our mind in any given instance. They can respond to it with whatever they want to put in our mind in any given instance. And they know what we're thinking, doing, feeling, and our physical problems at any moment in time.
Lorien, we're both blessed by having somebody. You know, my mother told me God knows my every move and thought, and I accepted that. And now I know two different ways that God knows my every move and thought. Because our seraphim, who watch over us every second of the day and night, I think of them as God's intelligence service. Besides
Absolutely.
Having that little spark of God inside each of us, which the Rancher book calls the thought adjuster. Some people don't like that name, but I think it's very good.
And if I think it's good.
Anybody out there hasn't read the Rancher book, that's the most comprehensive and least distorted history book on the planet. And you all ought to read it, because we're having the future connecting with the past now. All these revelations are coming out. So,
absolutely. Yep, absolutely. Yeah.
And so, let me make one more comment.
Sure.
On Time Stream Pictures, there are two other books there written by a lady in Vancouver who's now about 83. And they're called The Sea Gods After Atlantis and Teachings of the Sea Gods. And these books are given to her to spread to the world. And they're on the Time Stream Pictures website, and few people have seen them. Because when they were selling them, but when their supply ran out, they just started raising the price. And when I went online about a year ago, I saw only 9 books there. One of them, the cheapest one was $408, and one was being sold for $800. And they're for $25 now on Time Stream Pictures.
Oh, great. Okay. And now, do you think these are good depictions of what really happened after Atlantis? Or, you know, or do you think that she was channeled the correct information, in other words?
The one that she was given, she actually wrote 3 books. The third one is a self-help book. But these are 2 extremely important books for people to read soon. The one that gave her, been working with her all of her life, has become a personal friend of mine.
Oh, okay.
And I really appreciate that. But yes, these are higher intelligence. They Atlanteans were here for 60,000 years. They're the only species that has the continuous history for 60,000 years of this planet. And Atlanteans, when the last of their islands went under 10,500 years ago, they checked out some other tribes on the other islands or other continents, and they were very empathic, and the humans put out bad vibes. We were pretty barbaric back then. They liked the planet.
Hey,
they
Don, I got to interrupt you. We're still barbaric, but go ahead.
Some of us, they recognized that Valerie Bondrick was worthy of lifetime communication with.
Oh, cool. Well, Don, not to cut us short here, but we've only got about 9-8 minutes left in the show, and I do have a question from the chat room, and I'm wondering if you can answer it. You may not be able to. If you can't, don't worry about it, but it's an interesting question, I think, for you. It's from our gentleman in the chat room named Durhuff, and he says, please, Lorien, please ask Mr. Ware his view of Valiant Thor. Is he real or fake? If real, what was his message true to us?
He was real. I read his 1935 book, Outwitting Tomorrow. He was the alien in the Pentagon, and I think he was from Venus. You know, I know Dr. Strange's, and Dr. Strange's told me a lot about his buddies when he'd go on and visit Val Thor on the ships. He said he really enjoyed his buddies. I have a psychic friend who is being told in the middle of the night that Val Thor is watching what I'm doing right now. He's interested in getting this Genesis of the Space Race book out. You know, this guy here that wrote that, John B. Leith, had multiple interviews with a fellow ambassador to Earth from Venus. They're intelligent life living in all of the what they call 12 planets of our solar system. But the Earth is the only planet other than Venus, which is the headquarters. And these guys required our government to lie to us about conditions on the surface of Venus. They have intelligent life on the surface and in the inner Earth, just like we do. And we're talking about sending this spaceship past Pluto recently. We have had the ambassador from Pluto working with the ambassador from Venus and the ambassador from Mars in Washington, D.C. They all have offices in the same area. But, yeah, their ambassadors are here, have been here for a long time from Pluto.
Oh, great.
The world is a far different place than what most people are aware of, but it's being forced down your throats now. If you seek it, you will find it. It was a wise guy that said that.
Yes, absolutely. And see, that's why I tell everybody, you know, Don, I put on my conferences. You heard about that at the beginning of the show. And when I say to people, truly, honestly, it has nothing to do about with money for me. That's not what it's about. And, and I'm starving to death because of it. Not literally, but you know what I mean. And what I tell people is, honestly, I was called. I don't really have a choice in the matter. And I'm being propelled in that direction to get people educated about what's really going on out there. And I was told, I don't know about you, Don, but I was told that I was to examine every bit of information that came my way and not to be judgmental about it and to allow everyone their opinion as long as they weren't untruthful or found out to be liars and doing it from, if they were giving a presentation from their heart, that meant that they had made some connection with an extraterrestrial race or beings or other dimensional beings or whatever, and I couldn't be judgmental about what they had to say. So I was supposed
to be... That was good advice, Lorien.
Yeah. I mean, I was absolutely shocked that they were telling me this because I kept saying, well, what about the guys out there that are making this stuff up? They said, you'll know. And I said, oh, that's right. I will know because I'm psychic.
Well, I have to stand within the aura of someone when they're telling a story before I can determine whether it's true or not.
Absolutely.
I have learned that. I was told that was one of the messages from the captain that I need to sense the energies around people. For a recent retired Air Force staff scientist, that was pretty far out. But
yeah.
I had an experience that proved to me that those four psychics in the front row knew when the energy in that room changed because somebody with a negative energy stepped into the back door quietly. And I was watching all this happen. That's what inspired me to go ahead and start working on that, and I'm really pleased I did. I do, because I only have one ambition, and that's to be the happiest man in the world. And I,
absolutely.
In order to be happy, I need more than my share of love, excitement, self-satisfaction. So I sensed where those people, I call them fourth density society, hang out. And to be really happy, I don't go where the third grade classroom where you got a bunch of selfish people go. I go to six conferences every year where the positive, loving people go. And I don't know anybody happier.
So you know, I don't either. And I'll tell you, I go to four, five, six conferences a year myself. And everyone I go to, I see the same people. It's like we're all a big family. We all find each other. It's always amazing. And I have my what I call my conference family. And we have a great time together. So it's really cool. And I love it. And that's one
thing. I love talking to you, but did I answer that last gentleman's question?
Sure. Yeah, go ahead. I'm sorry.
Well, if somebody will remind me what it is.
It was the Thor, a Valiant Thor. And that
guy
who was on the show. Yeah.
Yeah. He's a hero of mine.
Oh, great.
And so is Saint Germain.
Absolutely.
I've only had one psychic reading, Lorien, and that was the late Ernestine Klein. And I told her I was curious about past lives, and she said that at one point I was on the staff of one of the early Egyptian pharaohs. This is well before King Tut. If you've been watching the Tut series, if you haven't, you ought to watch.
No, but. Yeah, I should watch it. Yeah,
that starts on Sunday. It's a 6-hour thing on driven over 3 nights. Said during the Roman Empire, I was a senator. You know, my first thought was, well, in this lifetime, I'm on the staff of the U.S. government, which is, you know, something close to a pharaoh, maybe same position. And I've been very curious about world government. And maybe that's why I've been led in that direction. But she said, in my most recent past life, I worked for Ashtar.
Oh, cool.
And
that's
if you understand that Ashtar is what I call the head of the police force for the solar system, he's there to make sure that all those angels and aliens and whoever's visiting this planet are not violating galactic law.
Absolutely.
So, yep. So I've had paranormal experiences where I met people that could only have worked for him. That's the only place that I could have met them that I can think of. And I now recognize that the Space Defense Force is, they're talking about the same thing. What they call the Space Defense Force now, I think, is probably the same guy I used to work for, the same team I used to work for.
Hmm. Wonderful.
So maybe that's why I can understand it easier than most people.
Exactly, yeah. Well, you know what, Don? I can't believe it, but 2 hours is almost completely gone by for us. I don't know where it went. That was like I was in a time warp or something. That was such fascinating information you gave us tonight, and thank you so much for being on the show. Everyone, this will be up in the archives very soon. I've got to start telling you the archives. You can get them by joining the Insiders Club. It's only $5 a month or $3? I can't remember. I think it's $3 or $5 a month, but whatever it is, please do join and get the archives because they're really important. And you know, listen to them. Listen to them two or three times. Yeah, $4.99. It's $4.99, folks. Okay, so thank you, Don, for being with me here tonight. And everyone, we'll see you next week on the California MUFON Radio Show.